What is Pulse? Pulse is a workflow engine that is geared towards corporations doing BDD workflows. It allows you to orchestrate entire workflows, linking together third-party tools via webhook and API calls. The tools that we link together are largely arbitrary. We are agnostic. We don't care which tools they are. We can set off anything with a webhook or an API call. Also, they can communicate to the Pulse engine with a webhook call. So as long as any of these tools are capable of being driven by or producing webhook or API calls, we can include them in our workflow. The sample workflow I'm going to demonstrate today is a BDD workflow that centers around Jira, a Bitbucket repository, qTest Pulse, of course, Jenkins, Slack, and qTest Manager. We also have a qTest plugin for Jira called qTest Scenario that allows an end user, such as a business analyst, to write Gherkin scripts in the cucumber format against issues in Jira as a part of the requirements. If we look at this diagram, we start in the upper left, where we're in Jira, editing our feature files within our issue in Jira. Once we save this feature file, it goes to a feature branch within a repository. We have our developers here also working out of the same repository that are able to provide the code behind those features as well as tests. Once the Bitbucket repository has been updated with a push, we send out a notification to the Pulse rules engine, wherein we authenticate ourselves to Jenkins via an API call. Jenkins will then grab the latest code from the Bitbucket repository, pull it down, performance build and test, and then send the test results directly to a qTest Pulse webhook endpoint for parsing and then delivery to qTest Manager via the API. Along the way, we'll also be sending certain notifications to Slack so that we can see what is going along the way. We also have the option to insert messaging it any other portion of this workflow, but we only use really two or three of them at this point in time. Of course, once all of your test results are updated in Manager, we see those reportable in qTest Insights. And also at the same time, our test results are coming back to Scenario so that we can link together our Scenario in Jira with the qTest test run. Our workflow starts here in Jira, as mentioned, and what we're looking at is a feature file that is tied to an issue within Jira. This is a story type of issue, and you can see down below that we have this whole scenario plugin area where we display the feature file. It is color-coded, and we have even line-by-line coloring to show that these tests have been run and have passed at one point. The tests that fail will be highlighted in red, of course. If I update this file and save it, it would kick off the entire workflow. If we take a look at the top here, we can see the repository that we are tied to, the branch that we are currently working out of. Take a note, master branch is not normally the best practice. This is just for the purposes of this demo. We can also see the feature file that we are tied to within our repository as well. If this were a new issue, you could click the magnifying glass icon, get a view of the feature files that are currently within the repository, and you can link it to a new issue if you so desire. You can also unlink your feature files from here as well. We also have the capability of doing a line-by-line autocomplete, so any steps that have been used previously are stored here within Scenario so that you can reuse them, which will allow you to reuse the portion of code that provides the test behind this requirement. I'm going to add an arbitrary line here. This line is something I have used before, but there is definitely no code behind it. So when I save this feature file, it will automatically fail this test for me. We'll be able to see the results coming into Jira here as well as qTest as a failure. Get the notification that our feature file has been saved. And we should be able to see some new notifications coming in here just in just a moment that show the various stages of our job. Jenkins build has been kicked off. Now Jenkins is performing its build. and tests, and it will be delivering that test results file back to Pulse for parsing. Once that file is parsed, it'll be delivered as a construct to the qTest API for delivery into qTest Manager, as well as to Scenario. And we'll see an entry come up for that in just a moment. There it is. Now that we have that, we'll also see a linking feature that takes place, and there it is. Now, if we follow through the workflow, I should be able to refresh this page now and see the failure that has just come in. You can see now that this is a failing test due to the qTest plugin, and you can now see the step that has failed. This is a good way for business analysts to track which tests are passing and failing at any given time. To follow along with the workflow, we'll move next to the repository that we are linked to, which is this one. And if I refresh this, we will see in the list the new change that I just implemented in the commit list. And now once this is updated, we have this configured to point to a trigger and pulse that will kick off Jenkins. And the Jenkins build has taken place, which we can see is number 9 right here. If we look at the configuration for Jenkins, we'll be able to see the source code again that we are representing. A build trigger, which allows us to kick this build off remotely via an API call to Jenkins. Our build step, as well as the step which takes the test results and deliver those to a qTest endpoint, along with a little more information, such as the project ID and the test cycle ID. These will tell us which location in qTest we want to store the results when they're done. After this, Pulse accepts the results file, does its parsing, and sends it back to the qTest API, where we then find it in qTest Manager. If I refresh this page, we should see that new failure coming in. And there it is, the kit should login requirement is now failing. And how does this all work? Most of these components are tied together utilizing qTest Pulse, which will give us a set of rules that we can then use to tie together various third-party components. If we take a look in Pulse, we see that there are several different sections to its UI. We have the rules, which tie together our triggers and actions. Of course, our triggers and our actions. And then constants, which are basically just a name value pair library that we can access from within our action scripts. If we follow the logic that we just took for our workflow through the system, we'll be able to see that we have events set up for everything, as well as a couple of additional rules that are for other frameworks as well. The triggers are just a webhook. The actions are a set of Node Framework JavaScript that allow you to determine the actions that want to take place. They can reference the constants library. And then in the rules, these actually tie together everything that we have with a drag and drop interface with our triggers on the left and our actions on the right. You can actually drag together as many actions as you like. However, I'm not going to change my workflow. And these will perform them sequentially as they're presented here. This tells us when this trigger or webhook is called, we want to be able to perform this action or actions on the right-hand side over here. You can also call actions from within other actions as well. To follow the workflow, the very first thing that happens after our repository is updated is we trigger Jenkins. So we see that webhook here, and we see the rule here. And we can also see how heavily we utilize the constants library here within the script, which allows us to authenticate ourselves to our Jenkins instance via the API and kick our build off. We're also doing an event emit here, which will allow us to call another Pulse event from within this action. This one is calling the Slack event, which would deliver a notification to our Slack instance to let us know what is going on. The next step after this, of course, is our parser. This occurs when Jenkins delivers the test results file to a Pulse endpoint, and that Pulse endpoint is then responsible for making sure that that results file gets parsed. If we take a look at these, it is called Format Java Cucumber. And what we're doing is we're taking in that payload, which has that result file in it, and we're iterating through that test result file and defining what those passes and failures are, adding any attachments, compiling those into a construct that is consumable by our API, and then we are sending it along to the next rule. There's the formatted results object. The next rule allows us to call two different actions, one of which is the scenario coloring action. This one takes those results and delivers them back to our scenario plugin in our Jira environment, so we get that line-by-line results coloring. The next one that is called is the update qTest, which will then take that formatted results construct and send it directly to our API, as you can see here on this line. We're also delivering more Slack notifications, as well as failure notifications should something go wrong with this rule. Additional notifications can be found if we look at, for instance, the trigger Jenkins rule and we view the logs. We will see a set of calls that have been made. Some of them will be passes, some of them will be failures. And if we look at any of these individual logs, we'll see the payload that is coming in, as well as some messaging from the console log, errors if they take place, in this case there isn't one, as well as a response. This response only takes place if there's an error, typically. After our results end up in qTest, of course, we'll be able to view them directly within qTest Manager. And see all the results, and we also have our requirements linked as well. The next video will take us through setting up this entire process, and we'll also be following the documentation on the support site to be able to accomplish this process.